everybody happy and enjoying each other's company and the fellowship happening, that's an awesome thing. So, you bet. Yes, what a beautiful Thanksgiving. Wow. We have so much to be thankful for. So we're going to count our blessings this morning. I'm not sure if you have to use your fingers or not, but we can sing about it while we're at it. Let's stand and turn to number 786 in the songbook. 786.
When upon life's billows you are tempest tossed, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done. Are you ever burdened with a load of care? Does the cross seem heavy you are called to bear? Count your many blessings, every doubt will fly, and you will be singing as the days go by. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done.
Verse 4.
So amid the conflict, whether great or small, do not be discouraged, God is over all. Count your many blessings, angels will attend. Help and comfort give you to your journey's end. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done.
Thank you. You may be seated.
Check, check, we're good? Right on. Well, good morning. Welcome. There are many, just when you think you get everybody figured out, there's a whole bunch of new faces show up on a holiday weekend. But welcome, home here to Rolla. We're so glad to have you with us today, and especially for those who are made the nice big long trip out from PRBI. Welcome back. If you would join with me in a responsive reading this morning in Psalm 136. Oh, I guess we didn't turn the computer on today. It's not a very hard responsive reading. You have four words to say every time. So if you could respond to me with, "His love endures forever." Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. Give thanks to the God of gods. Give thanks to the Lord of lords. To him alone, who alone does great wonders, who by his understanding made the heavens, who spread out the earth upon the waters, who made the great lights, the sun to govern the day, the moon and stars to govern the night. He remembered us in our low estate and freed us from our enemies. He gives food to every creature. Give thanks to the God of heaven. His love endures forever. Just a few announcements this morning. After the service, we will be having our Thanksgiving potluck, so please feel free to stay and join us for that. There will be no Sunday school today because of the potluck, so just keep that in mind. The last Sunday this week will be the last Sunday for the Bible study sign-up. We're trying to get Bible studies going, so if you have interest in either attending, hosting, or even leading, please sign up, put your name, your location, where you're at, and your phone number, so I can contact you later. And we are going to start getting those sorted out here probably this week. So please sign up for Bible studies. And then another thing that Candace and I have been thinking about, we're thinking about starting a, I think we call a mom's cafe, starting in November. So we're going to start using the church probably one day a week, invite all the mothers and the young children in town to come and play in the Sundays or in the preschool room, and they can hang out, have some coffee, and chat, and we can do a ministry here in Rolla for the mothers. And so we're also going to be looking for some volunteers that are maybe willing to make some baked goods ahead of time, as well as, you know, if you wanted to come and serve coffee or even just come and participate, hang out with the ladies and get to know them and play with the kids. So we're going to start looking at doing that probably November. And other than that, I think that's it. I'd like to call up our ushers and we'll pray for our offering. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for a day where we get to dedicate just time for Thanksgiving. We thank you for all the wonderful gifts that you have given each of us, both financially, in our families, the people, our friends, our church. We are thankful. Help us to give generously in the same way, to give back to you so we can be thankful as well as you grow your kingdom, as you grow your church, that this gift to you would be for furthering your kingdom, we pray. We just thank you, we love you, we honor you today. In your name, amen.
Well, that sure is something to be thankful for, that his love, his mercy endures forever. Hey, if we didn't have that, we wouldn't have nothing to be thankful for. One thing I'm thankful for today is for my mother. Today would have been her birthday. She passed away probably 51 years ago, I guess. I was just a little gaffer then. But God has took me through life and taught me to grow up and give me so many other blessings to boot, but most of all his love, his salvation in my life. Let's stand and turn to number 572, Blessed Assurance.
blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
And number 738. The wonder of it all.
There's the wonder of sunset at evening, the wonder of sunrise I see, but the wonder of wonders that thrills my soul is the wonder that God loves me. Oh, the wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me. Oh, the wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me. There's the wonder of springtime and harvest, the sky, the stars, the sun, but the wonder of wonders that thrills my soul is a wonder that's only begun. The wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me. Oh, the wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me.
Thank you. You may be seated. What an amazing thought to know that God loves us. This awesome creator, the one who created everything that you can think of. I mean, to me, that I remember the first time I heard that song, and it was just, it really, really hit me, like, wow. This God that created the world, created everything I can see, and yet, like, it's so immense, it's so huge, and yet he thinks of you and me, and he thinks of us individually. He doesn't think of us as a big group of people that he really cares about. He thinks of you and he thinks of me. That's just an awesome, awesome thought. I just wanted to read a few verses in Psalm 63 before we pray. Just something that I read this week that really encouraged me. O God, you are my God. Early will I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh longs for you in a dry and thirsty land where there is no water. So I have longed for you in the sanctuary to see your power and your glory. Because your loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall praise you. Thus will I bless you while I live. I will lift up my hands in your name. My soul shall be satisfied as with marrow and fatness, and my mouth shall praise you with joyful lips. When I remember you on my bed, I meditate on you in the night watches. Because you have been my help, therefore, in the shadow of your wings will I rejoice. My soul follows close behind you. Your right hand upholds me. Is there any prayer requests this morning? Go ahead, Margaret. What's her name?
Her name is Monique, but it's Dawn.
Okay.
So place the healing and go spiritually with them.
Mm-hmm. Great, Gord. Rory.
I have a friend who went to Bible school last year, and her dad is doing like some pretty severe health issues. And she hasn't been able, she's going to university with Catherine, so she hasn't been able to go home and see him. She's really trying to figure it right now. So just pray that he would heal up quickly in that.
Let's bow our heads. Father, I thank you for such a beautiful morning. I thank you for your love to us, your mercy to us, Father. It's incredible. We cannot bring words to describe the joy you put in our hearts and the thankfulness in our hearts, Father. I thank you that you know. Father, I thank you that you know where our hearts are at. And Father, I just pray that you would continue to lead us and guide us. Guide us in your way, Father. I pray that your kingdom would come, and that your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, Father. There is so many things we can say, and Father, I just thank you so much for everything that you do and have, most of all for what you have done through Jesus, Father. That we can have salvation, that we can have a personal relationship with you through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit in us, Father. I just thank you so much for that. I just pray that you would go with us this morning, Father. I thank you too for that we can bring our request to you, Father, and that I pray for Margaret's friends, Don and Monique, Father. I just pray that you would bless them and strengthen them. Father, I pray that you'd be with Don, and Father, I pray that you'd help him to make his calling and election sure. Father, we have nothing without you, without your salvation, Father. And I just pray that you would touch his heart, Father, that his sickness would help him to think and to drive him to his knees to make sure of his salvation, Father, and bless his wife, Father. Help him to be a strong support to him and to pray for him too, Father. I just pray that you would take care of that situation, Father. I thank you for Gord. I thank you that he's thankful this morning, Father, and I thank you that I pray that each one of us will share in that thankfulness, especially this morning on Thanksgiving Day, Father. I just pray that you would grant us thankful hearts. But Father, I pray that we would have that throughout the rest of the year too. And Father, for Roy's friend, I pray for her dad, Father. I just mental health is something that we don't understand, Father, and it's heavy on our hearts, those kind of things, Father. We can't take a few pills at the cupboard and go on about our day. It's something that we don't understand, Father. And I just pray that you would touch her daddy's mind and soul and heart, Father, and heal him, and Father, that she could spend time with her daddy again. I pray too for Dave and Kit Furon, Father. I just pray that you would touch their hearts, Father. They've been religious all their lives. They're old people now, Father, and it seems that they're looking back to their religion for strength, which in and of itself is okay, but Father, that Jesus Christ would be their salvation. Father, I just pray that you would be with Susie and bless her, Father. Give her opportunity. Give her lots of opportunity to talk to them about Jesus. And Father, I just pray that you would open her eyes and ears, and most of all their hearts, to hear about Jesus, to hear the full message, Father, that they would then let their hearts be bent toward you, Father. I pray that you'd be with David this morning. I pray that you would speak through the words that he speaks, Father. May our hearts be encouraged and lifted up again as by your word, the word that David's going to speak, Father. I just pray that you would bless us this morning, bless him with strength and wisdom, Father. Draw us to you this morning. I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Working good. Logan, you're going to have to be on the ball in the back there this morning. I might end up coughing here and there, and you just got to be ready on that mute button. At least somebody will be paying attention this morning. Well, it is good to be alive. It's good to be up here. Let's see here. We will slowly get all of the kinks figured out as far as me figuring out that I should have this all set up before the service goes. And so we will get to a nice smooth service one day, but I'm grateful that we're not a super professional church, so I know you guys have some grace for that. Today we're talking about God's Word. I'm excited about this. Specifically, we're talking about preaching God's Word. You might think to yourself, well, you know, hopefully, of course, we're going to be talking about God's Word. We're in church this morning. Why do we need to be talking about preaching? David, that's what we hired you to do. Just do it. Well, preaching it's a very, very important part of the church. As we find in Ephesians 4:11, James even instructed in James chapter 3 that not many should become teachers, because those that teach will be judged more strictly. He then goes on to describe how the tongue is, it's like a bit in a horse's mouth. Or like a small rudder on a large ship. It steers, the tongue has the ability to steer the body where it may go. And so what is taught, especially here on a Sunday morning, is of great importance to the health of a church. And as the body of Christ, where is it that we want to be steered? And now standing here as your new pastor, where is it that as a church, as Rolla Bible Baptist Church, where is it that we want to be steered? Where do we want to go? Well, James also says, you know, that the tongue is a dangerous thing. And I don't know if you caught the little interesting Easter egg in last week's sermon recording. A few did. But apparently that as I was preaching, I ended up fumbling over a couple words. And a very explicit swear word seemed to form out of those two mispronounced words. And so, out of my misbelief and thinking that, well, there goes my career here at Rolla, Dan so graciously called me to inform me of the blunder and to assure me that I wouldn't be fired after my first sermon. Well, I quickly took the video down. We edited out that unfortunate part. And so, to anybody that did hear it, my apologies. There was no way intentional. But the tongue, wow, the tongue. Today, we are diving into our first mark in our remarkable series that we are going through called Marks of a Healthy Church. These marks are to give evidence of health within a church. So last week, we looked at the marks of what a true church, what makes a true church, helping us to get that understanding of what constitutes a true church. And so now that we have established that we are a true church, we will now begin to look at our own church's health. And so, as I said last week, there are many true churches out there, but few, sadly, are truly healthy. So let's begin on this endeavor to build up the health of our church together. Well, as we've already covered from James, while the tongue is small, it has the ability to control the whole body. He speaks of taming the tongue because it has the ability to wreak havoc. But as he begins this section cautioning people from being teachers, I think we can see that what is taught and preached in church on Sunday will have a direct correlation to the health of that local church. And so that is why today we are talking about preaching God's Word and why God's Word is central to what we teach and preach here at Rolla Bible Baptist Church. It's also the first mark, and because it's by and large the most important mark of them all. Just as the tongue guides the body, God's Word is to guide the church. And if we can get this right, all of the other marks that we're going to cover in future sermons should fall into place. And that is our hope. As we're talking about preaching God's word, I'm going to make the argument that it's through what's called expositional preaching that we find the greatest health in a church. Why expositional preaching? What is expositional preaching, you're probably asking yourself. What does that even mean? Well, expositional preaching is teaching that exposes God's word to God's people. All right? The teaching that exposes God's word to God's people. Isn't that what all teaching and preaching is? Well, not necessarily. The two main forms of preaching that we find today will either be topical or expositional. The difference lies largely, we'll say, in how the preacher or the teacher approaches the text. And so a topical sermon, you've probably heard many in your time. A topical sermon will generally come from the pastor picking a topic, like faith, or sin, or adoption, or even the church. And then the pastor will pick the passage that from Scripture that aligns with that particular topic. Expositional preaching, an expositional sermon begins with the Scripture. Then through the reading of that passage and determining the context in which it was written, the point of the sermon is determined by the point of the passage. And that's a crucial difference. And so a simple way to say it is if we were going to go through the book of Ephesians, we would just deal with each section of Scripture as Paul had intended it for his readers. And then we would try to figure out how that then applies to us today. Well, funnily enough, I am arguing for expositional preaching, even though we're currently going through a topical sermon. So much for my credibility. But once we're finished this series, we are going to begin to largely go through expositional series, working our way through God's Word. And as you've already been blessed in this way through much of Bob's preaching. Over the years, he's rightly found that it was easier to expose you to God's word and let the Spirit do the rest. And so that is what my plan is, anyway, is to go through God's word as it is, no matter what it is, and just and let us grow and learn together. But we can, however, do a topical sermon expositionally. And so today, I'd like you to turn with me to Isaiah 55, verses 10 to 11. And as we'll see in this passage, the reason why preaching God's word has to be so central to our church is because God's word creates and sustains. God's word creates and sustains. So let us read, starting in verse 10 to 11 of Isaiah 55.
As the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish so that it yields seed for the sower, bread for the eater. So my word that goes out from my mouth will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it.
Well, in the context that we're reading here in Isaiah, Israel is about to get taken off to exile by the Assyrians. They've continued to turn away from God, despite the many times of God's remembering and deliverance. Isaiah, he's prophesied Israel's doom, but he's also prophesied Israel's comfort in the Lord. That despite everything that they have done out of their disobedience, God had a plan to save Israel and send them a Savior. And so as we move into chapter 55, God is speaking through Isaiah of being their refuge. He is inviting them to come to him. He is calling Israel to come to him in repentance. And then we find here in verses 10 to 11, this short passage describing the wonderful beauty and worth that comes from God's word. from his voice. God is speaking. He is comparing his word to the water that comes from heaven, the rain and the snow. It waters the earth. It causes the ground to bud and flourish. God's word creates and sustains. Well, just as the water causes the ground to bud and flourish, God's word brings forth life. We see this in creation, in the creation account in Genesis, and that it was by God's word that life begins. Seven times in the first 24 verses of Genesis, it's written, "And God said," and something was created, something was given life. And not only in creation, but we see it in the formation of his people, that it was by God's word to Abraham and that his descendants would become God's people. That was spoken by God's word, that Israel would be his people. And it was God's word that Peter preached and people heard at Pentecost in Acts chapter 2. And so it was by God's word that the church was formed. As God speaks, life is given. He creates. And it says it, the water yields seed for the sower. It's this idea of creation and life continuing the cycle. With new seed, new life is created. New life, or life itself, is sustained. Despite, you know, what probably many in the Lower Mainland will argue, that you get your food from the grocery store, it takes a lot of work to plant that, to sow that seed, to create new life and new food. And so farmers have a job to do in bringing new life by sowing that seed and continuing the cycle of life. And so God's word is vital in continuing the life of the church and growing his kingdom, which is also the church. And so we have experienced that new life that God has given us through the power of his word. If we have come to faith in Christ, what does he call us? He calls us a new creation. We are a new creation, and that is only found in Christ, who is revealed to us by his word. God's word creates and sustains. Well, just as the rain and the snow yield seed for the sower, it also provides bread for the eater. God's word provides nourishment for the hearer. What does bread do for the eater? We all know this. It satisfies a hunger. You know, it may provide comfort. I really do. Candace will argue I don't eat it as much, probably because it comforts me too much. But I really just enjoy a nice slice of toast with butter on it. Oh, that is good. Simple and good. It's comforting. But above all, bread also provides health, and it helps us to grow. Just as bread does that for those who eat it, God's word satisfies our hunger. When we want to know him more, we just need to come to his word, and we can be satisfied. God's word is comforting. It helps us to put into perspective our struggles and our pains, and we can look into his word and see that we have hope and life in Jesus Christ. There is coming a day when our struggles will end, and until then, his love, his mercy and his grace will see us through. That we can be comforted in his word. His word also provides health and growth. It sustains and nourishes us. Without God's word, we would be dead. We are spiritually dead without his words. His word maintains life. This is why it is the core of what makes us a church and what will make us a healthy church. Because we cannot stray from his word. We need our daily bread. We need his word regularly if we are both to survive and to thrive. And we need it both here on a Sunday morning, and we need it in our daily rhythm. as we continue in this passage in Isaiah, I spent some time trying to understand the use of the word empty in verse 11. If God's word was to return to him empty, what would that even mean? What does this mean? Well, the best I can understand is just in the relation to empty words. I recently saw a clip of a TED Talk called, How to Sound Smart in a TED Talk. It's pretty funny. You should look it up. It's a good laugh. But the speaker here, Will Steven, he's essentially explaining how to move a crowd with a speech without actually saying anything. You know, someone ended up taking the clip. It's not in the original, but, you know, they put the moody piano music. You know, it kind of makes it sound like he's like a pastor speaking in a large church. You know, you've got the synthesizer just playing two different notes off and on the entire time he's speaking. It's kind of setting that mood. And as he described, you know, he gets started, you know, you tell a story, you get the crowd to laugh, tell something funny, even, you know, add some self-deprecation in there to get people to find you relatable and likable, and gets everybody relaxed. And then as that happens, you know, he moves into some instruction, and you start explaining how that funny story actually, you know, has so much to do with the point that I'm trying to share with you, and I'm telling you how that that relates to each other. And then as he starts talking, he says, you know, he starts speaking emphatically, you know, you start to raise your voice, and you speak quickly in a way that it starts to build tension to those that are listening, and you're caught, you're in the moment, before finally you just slow the pace right down, and you go long and quiet, so that the listeners, you're brought to the state of emotional release, and you're hanging on my every word. Well, in the course of that presentation, he essentially said nothing at all. He even admitted that he said nothing. And I just said nothing. His words were empty and meaningless. But the crowd responded exactly how he wanted them to. Preaching without God's word is empty. It has no lasting value. In our culture, I've seen many different churches. I've seen many different internet sermons, there are examples galore, but man, we can be very easily stirred up emotionally, even when the words being spoken mean nothing at all. We can be easily caught up in the charismatic nature of someone's personality, even though what they say means nothing. Be on guard, pay attention to the words that are said on a Sunday morning. Put them to the test. Develop your own litmus test. What is it that they are saying? How do you determine that they are speaking the word? And I want you to hold them to it, the ones that you listen to on the internet. It's okay to listen to some preachers on the internet. I'm okay. You can do that as long as you come back Sunday. But I want you to hold me to that same standard as well. I want you to hold me accountable to that same standard. God's words are never empty. They're full of life, and they will accomplish what God desires and achieve the purpose for which he sent it. It is our duty to preach those words. Well, what are God's desires? What is the purpose for which he sent it? Well, God's word is, I believe, to bring us back to him. God spoke to create, to bring new life, and continues to do so through his word. But why do we have the Bible? Why did he choose to reveal himself to us in his word? I think it's because he wants to bring us back to him. That Adam and Eve messed it up. He spoke them into the creation. They walked with him. He had a relationship with them, and they separated themselves from God. And yet, in removing them from the garden, God gave them a promise as he cursed the serpent, that her offspring would crush the head of the serpent. He gave a word of hope that day, that one day Jesus would come back and he would defeat Satan. That he would make it possible for us to be in relationship with him again if we would turn to him. As I was reading this week, J. Alec Motyer wrote this in the Old Testament commentary on Isaiah. He said, "Here again is a truth of wide and important application. The Word of God in our privileged day, the Holy Scriptures, comes from the Lord himself and is the chosen instrument to achieve his purposes. The Bible reveals his thoughts and his ways. It sets his targets. It voices his promises and is powerful to achieve what it expresses." But immediately in this passage, the focus is narrower, as we are here in Isaiah 55. It speaks particularly of the divine word in the call to repentance, the command to come back to God, the promises of compassion and forgiveness. These are effective in achieving what they say, not because the sinner responds and uses words of penitence and faith, but because God has spoken. So God is calling us to come to him through his word. It is a call to turn, to repent. And as we look just a little bit further up, in verses 6 to 7, Isaiah says, "Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their ways and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord, and he will have mercy on them, and to our God, for he will freely pardon." He will have mercy, and he will freely pardon. I'm thankful for that today. Let's take some time. Let's reflect and remember on what God has done in our own lives. What has God's word changed in your life? I want you to think about this. What has God's word changed in your life? What has God's word, or how has God's word brought you new life? How has God's word brought you comfort and peace? How has it brought you strength to just keep going? How has God's word encouraged you in your own walk, or perhaps convicted you of a much needed change? How has God's word brought you to where you are right now? If you can see how God's word has done those things in your life, how important it has been in your own life, how much more important is it here in the life of our church? Perhaps you've been a Christian for most of your life. Maybe you haven't given yourself to the studying of God's word. If you look back on your life, has there been much growth in your life, if any? Do you want to grow? Do you want to be spiritually healthy? I've known some friends who were Christians their whole life and have never once read through the Bible in its entirety. That's a clear mark that God's word is not the center of your life. And so I would encourage you, make it the center of your life. God has spoken to us. Just think about that. God, our creator, the one who made the heavens and earth, has spoken to us specifically. That he has given his word to us. That despite our best efforts as the human race, despite our best efforts to completely separate ourselves from him, yet he has still revealed himself to us in his word. That his word has continued throughout history, despite our best efforts to shut it down. And now we still have it today. And not only that, but we are on the side of history where Christ has already been revealed to us. We didn't have to sit, like Israel, waiting for the coming Savior. That we get to know who he is. We get to look back on that already. And we get to know that he has already made it possible for us to be in a relationship with him. How wonderful is that? That he has spoken to us and he has called us to respond. So how do we grow in health together as God's people here in Rolla? How do we grow together? Well, one, it's going to be through time spent in His Word. That's a given. And that needs to be individually and corporately. Within the church, we're going to grow in health through expositional preaching, through being exposed to God's Word no matter what it says. All right, I'm not going to pick and choose just because the verse might be a little bit more difficult for us to get. It might stir us up a little bit in our hearts. All right, we're going to approach God's Word no matter what it says. Topical sermons can be good, but a full diet of them is not healthy. Because as I pick those topics, I'm going to generally end up picking topics that I want to cover. And I'm going to approach the text with understandings that I already have. And so if I'm not growing in my understanding of Scripture, of God's Word, as far as Sunday morning is concerned, you will only be able to grow to my level of understanding. But if we commit ourselves to the teaching and studying of Scriptures as it is laid out in God's Bible for us, we will continue to grow in health and understanding for all the years that we have together. And it's my prayer that I will be growing. I am so much, so many of you are so much farther already in your faith. You know, some of you have been Christians longer than I've been alive. Not necessarily. And so together we will read God's Word together and study that. And so we will do series. We're going to work through a book in the Bible, understanding not only the richness that is in each individual verse, but the context in each that each story resides in, the overall message that each book is trying to convey, and the place that each book fits in with the grand biblical narrative that is God's revealed plan throughout history. And with each of those, we are going to begin to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of our Lord Jesus Christ. So I do plan on doing topical sermons once in a while. A bit of a treat or a palate cleanser. They can be good, just like we're doing right now. But I believe that we will best be served by simply exploring God's Word together. So throughout each week, another one, how are we going to grow? As we said, we're going to start doing some Bible studies midweek. Different Christian book studies and series can be helpful to work through together in small groups, but I believe if you really want to grow in health, the best diet is God's Word directly. And so as we work towards setting up some Bible study groups, I want to encourage those of you who will be part of them to study God's Word first and foremost. Well, let's go over some responsibilities now. My responsibility. Oh. Wow, we really messed up there. All right. My responsibility is to steer the church with God's Word, not my own ideas. So what comes out of my tongue needs to be God's Word, not my own ideas. I am to preach the Word. Not what is culturally popular. I am to preach the Word. My job as your pastor is to hold out the Word of life to those who need it for their souls. Amen. That you can come and find comfort in God's Word here on a Sunday morning. My job is to expose you to God's Word. Not just preach the truth, but to show you where and how you can get the truth. That to be filled, that you would not just have to come here on a Sunday morning to be filled spiritually, but that you can at any time go and dig into your Bibles, that you will know how to do that, how to read, to study, and to be filled by the Spirit Himself. My job is to equip you for ministry, not do it for you. So what is your responsibility? Well, your responsibility is to hold me to a high standard of studying God's Word. All right, you are to hold me accountable. No empty sermons here in Rolla. Amen? All right. Hold other speakers to that same high standard. All right, the ones you listen to on the internet, even if you're going to somebody else's church, hold them to that same standard. Your responsibility is also to ask me questions, not follow me blindly. All right, one word of note as your new pastor is, as I preach, you are welcome to disagree. All right, but it's okay to be wrong. No, you are welcome to disagree. I do not admit that I have it all figured out. And I'm learning, I'm studying it along with you, and I want to figure that out together. But you are welcome to disagree and come to different conclusions than I am. You're encouraged to ask questions. Not mid-sermon, but in Sunday school. And any time during the week, please feel free to come to me and to clarify, to ask. If what I say here on a Sunday morning gets you thinking and growing in your understanding of Scripture, especially if you disagree, that really gets you thinking. And it gets you thinking of how, you know, how am I more convicted on this than I was before? And I think that's a really good thing, because we don't always have to agree. And so if you can grow further in your life as a Christian, because you're asking questions, if you can start learning what it means to be a Christian, who our wonderful God is, I think I'm gonna feel like I'm being successful. So I encourage that. And I promise that I'm gonna preach the word, and I'm gonna preach it to the best of my ability. Your job is also to come prepared to learn. I'm gonna actually start doing a thing, probably on Facebook, or we're gonna send it on the email. It'll be up on the website as well. But you can check anywhere. I'm going to end up posting either the next Sunday's sermon passage for you to look at. If things change, they change, but I want you to be prepared. I want you to have time to study in the Word before you come on a Sunday, so that you can actually engage. You can see and you can really own what is being said here on a Sunday. All right, so I'm going to let you be prepared, and I want to encourage you to take that opportunity and to study the next sermon's passage over the week. Your job, your responsibility, is to read the Word, to pray over it, to put your life under it. That is our responsibility. And your responsibility is also to pray for me as I study and prepare each week. Well, looking ahead, one day, you know, we're not going to need to listen to sermons. You're thinking, well, amen. or even read the Bible to understand and get to know our Heavenly Father. We're not even going to need faith anymore, because we will see our Lord. Revelation 22:4 says, they will see his face. And that will be a glorious day. But until that day, remember that we have been greatly blessed, richly blessed with his word. That it is sufficient. It is all we need. Together, let us hold firmly to the word of life. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you so much for your word. God, as we look forward, help us to be convicted, to feel the weight and the blessing that is your word. That we would desire to be drawn to you, that we would desire to hunger after you, to be satisfied, to be comforted. God, that you would just continue to give us new life. We pray that through your word, that there would be new life in your kingdom, new life brought here in this town of Rolla, new life brought to the town of Dawson Creek, to this whole area. We pray that your word would go out, that you would be revealed, that you would change lives. We thank you for what you have done here in this church. We are grateful. And God, we are looking forward to what you are going to do through your word in teaching us and growing us here in this church in the days ahead. So God, we just give We give that to you. Father, teach us, instruct us, guide us, convict us. Push us further in our faith, in our understanding of who you are, in our love for one another. We love you, Lord. We thank you. In your name, amen. To invite the worship team up.
The word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, and that keeps going. That's so true. Let's stand and turn to number 348, My Savior's Love. We'll sing number 1, 4, and 5.
Stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful in my song shall ever be. Is my Savior's love for me. He took my sins and my sorrows, he made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone. How marvelous, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. When with the ransomed in glory his face I at last shall see, 'twill be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
Number 815. We'll sing it twice.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Sorry, a little unprepared. Psalm 100, shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. Let's bow our heads. Father, I thank you so much for another beautiful morning to get together with your people, worship you, Father. I just pray that this will have been another service that truly glorified you, Father. I truly feel that it did, Father, and I just thank you for the peace and the blessing in our hearts that you give. And Father, I just thank you for each one here. I pray that you'd bless each one. Bless us through this week, Father. Help us to honor you. Help us to grow in our walk with you, and to shed the light that you put in our hearts and in our lives, Father. I thank you for the word as it was preached, and I pray that you bless David and his family, Father. I thank you now for the wonderful Thanksgiving meal that we all smell down there, Father. I just pray that you would bless each one and bless the food. I thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. With that, you're dismissed, and you are very, very welcome to stay. We would highly appreciate if you do, even if you didn't end up bringing something. There's always way too much food anyway, so please do join us.